You know how we were going for herd immunity as a country? Well, forget about that, because apparently it's not going to happen. And that's not just me saying it, which wouldn't count for literally anything. It's the people who had really been hoping and working to make it a reality. According to a new report in the New York Times, more than half of adults in the US have been inoculated with at least one dose of vaccine, but daily vaccination rates are slipping, something like 20% over the past few weeks. And there's widespread consensus among scientists and public health experts that the herd immunity threshold is not attainable, at least not in the foreseeable future, and perhaps not ever. Instead, these scientists believe that rather than COVID being booted out of our country, being yeeted into the sun, it's instead going to become a manageable threat that will continue to circulate for years to come, causing hospitalizations and deaths, but in much smaller numbers. So that's fun, Francesca. Our worst fears, perhaps, I guess the worst fear would be no vaccine at all. Our second worst fear realized.
Yeah. I mean, look, 2020 crushed all hopes and dreams and even minor expectations. So, you know, other than the 6th of January, 2021 has been kind of crushing it. I mean, the 6th also crushed it a lot. But the point is that I have very little expectations. And I've been waiting for the other shoe to drop because I'm an American and I live in this country. And I know there's always shoes are gonna be dropping. So not it's reaching herd immunity. Kids. Oh, it's raining other shoes in this hellscape we live in. But yes, what is awful about it is the way that it has a lot to do with distrust in the vaccine, right? And I would almost say that like having vying different pharma companies roll out their version of a vaccine also doesn't help, because now we have things that are pitted against one another. We have certain vaccines that are, you know, people snub their nose at versus others, even though they are incredibly effective and far, far better. Whatever side effects are far better than actually getting COVID. And anyone who's gotten a vaccine and felt mild symptoms has been like, oh man, I'm so glad that I don't actually have COVID, because it would be 20 times worse and that would suck.
Yeah.
But I don't think, look, the rollout's been amazing, but at the same time, it doesn't really help that we don't just have the COVID vaccine. We've got like this bizarre hierarchy of pharma as well as waiver patents that I know we're gonna go into.
Totally. Yeah. Look, if you're totally not talking about public perception and playing into misinformation, all that, having the multiple vaccines is helpful in a lot of different ways, obviously, objectively. But sure, it has caused some issues. By the way, in terms of the misinformation and, you know, some of the different things that are leading to vaccine hesitance, watch last week tonight, the last episode of John Oliver's show went into it. Don't give me that, Sophie. It was a good episode. It was exactly what I thought it was gonna be. It was a bit about India and then it went into vaccines. That's what I would have made it. And so John Oliver did, because we were attached through some sort of etheric cord. But anyway, so what is going to happen? Well, we have this dark future mapped out. We don't know exactly what it looks like. How much smaller the threat becomes is currently uncertain and depends in part on how much of the nation and the world becomes vaccinated, but also how the coronavirus continues to evolve, which it will, because we won't have herd immunity. It's already clear, however, that the virus is changing too quickly. New variants are spreading too easily and vaccination is proceeding too slowly for herd immunity to be within reach anytime soon. And it's, I think, been made fairly explicit in the segment. None of this needed to happen. And I don't just mean about this story. I mean, literally anything with the pandemic, none of it needed to happen. We're the worst and we're led by the worst of the worst. But we could have hit herd immunity. We could still do it if we did not have a significant chunk of the country that has taken up as their political identity that they don't want the Bill Gates super chip put in their cerebral lobe. But unfortunately, that's where we're at. And so I want to give you a little bit from Dr. Fauci, who said people were getting confused and thinking you're never going to get the infections down until you reach this mystical level of herd immunity, whatever that number is, which by the way, he has given many times. But anyway, that's why we stopped using herd immunity in the classic sense. I'm saying forget that for a second. You vaccinate enough people, the infections are going to go down. So that is a big old stepping back from what they had been saying about the efforts to hit herd immunity. And he's not wrong. Every person vaccinated makes it a little bit harder for the disease to spread and to evolve and to become worse and all of that. But it is still a massive surrender, unfortunately, but probably a realistic one because, you know, no matter what we might aim to do, shows like this are not gonna reach virtually any of these hesitant people. They believe that I'm paid off by Soros, who is the devil. I don't know. It's just it's unfortunate, Francesca.
But I also think it's
despairing.
It is despairing. I have a couple of questions about the concept of herd immunity. First of all, the herd immunity idea was floated early on by a lot of folks who did COVID the worst, right? So like Sweden, Donald Trump. And they kept on utilizing the phrase herd immunity as basically as soon as everyone gets sick, we'll be fine. And it really, I think, indoctrinated or got people used to this idea that look, it's just a little flu and you'll survive it. Yeah, 500,000 people or more will die, but like, you know, probably not your family or maybe your family, but like whatever. And so it was a terrible concept to begin with because even the idea of herd immunity is essentially not everyone has to be inoculated a little bit. That like blanket, if 3 out of 4 are, well then the fourth is fine. So, you know, folks go around, especially in this country, thinking, well, I'm the fourth, I'm fine. Like the whole concept again, it's been bastardized, it's not okay to use. And so for me, under a Biden administration, the fact that we started going back to this idea of herd immunity seemed really bizarre. And I don't even know why they kept on saying it. Why not just like, look, we need 70% of the American public inoculated. That's the goal. Make it the goal, set the goal, call it something else. Right? But don't call it herd immunity because it just, again, it gives people the idea, the false idea that you don't have to get vaccinated. You can fly under the radar. And basically, if everyone else around you is inoculated or that person had COVID, then you'll be fine.
Yeah.
And the reality is the opposite. The reality is that those folks who have not been inoculated, not gotten the vaccine, actually can start to create a new variant of this disgusting virus we can't shake called COVID. And that, it is going to be endemic, a part of our lives. Yeah. And I don't know, man, I'm not cool with shaking hands. Just like I'm just not going back there. I'm just not going back to shaking hands. And look, I was never really a mosher to begin with, but I'm definitely not gonna like mosh it up in the future. And like wither hardcore.
You can mosh, you just gotta put on like the Walter White, like top to bottom thing, then you can mosh. You'll probably slip, unfortunately. And like you said, it's just gonna be out there. And the issue is, that is its own persistent tragedy that I guess will just be added to the long list of daily tragedies we have here in America. But also, they might be the breeding ground for a variant that will be able to affect those who have attempted to be responsible. And so that's a big issue too. Yeah. And look, I would say overall the focus on herd immunity, I agree with some of your concerns. I would also add, I think rhetorically, in terms of persuasion, one of the strategies was, let's get people to like pitch in together. Don't just do it for you, do it for everyone else. You don't want to kill people, do you? And all of that sounds like so common sense, but no, you stupid idiots. Americans don't care about any of that stuff. Like, conservatives they've been trained for years now to believe that an excessive concern for the well-being of others is basically the most suspect thing in the world.
Right.
I mean, whether you call it social justice warrioring or being woke or whatever, the bad people in society are those who worry about others. I'm not one of those people. I'm worried about me first and foremost.
I'm not a warrior for social justice. Ew.
Exactly. No, but really, that is what they've been trained. Like their political identity is go it alone, care about yourself, maybe your family, maybe your church, if you're feeling generous. But like only like the good ones in your church, honestly. Anyway, so as a strategy, I understand why they landed where they did, but it was sort of doomed to failure because none of the other stuff earlier about your responsibility as part of the Commonwealth and being a member of society and all that about, they don't wear masks to save lives. You think they're gonna get an injection to save lives? They won't stand at a distance from people to save lives. Why are they gonna put chips in their body or whatever? So yeah, that's difficult.
But I do think that if one of us, like this is something I haven't thought of, but if we all just like bring one friend, you know, like find a buddy who's worried about getting the vaccine. If you can find one person in your family, in your community, in your extended folks, if you can bring one person along, that will have been worth it. So I will say that, like, we all, not to get too Sesame Street on you, but we all have a part to play. No, we do. So like, let's all do that. Yeah, no, Grover for sure. Let's all do that and bring somebody along who might be hesitant, go with them ourselves. I think that would mean a lot.
Yeah, no, that's a good idea. And that was, by the way, basically the conclusion of John Oliver, that obviously his show isn't gonna reach any of these people. They would never watch a minute of it, but it's on us to do the incredibly difficult job of convincing even one person that the stuff they've read on Facebook might not be true. So anyway, try that. For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.